Hi there, Hi Voice here. Let me tell you all about symbols. WinDBG requires symbols to work, and this can be daunting to a new user of WinDBG. Let me try to cover the basics of how it works, and you can go from there. If you're a veteran at WinDBG, then maybe this video is going to cover everything you possibly know, but definitely do stick around. I might have a trick or two at the end which you have never seen, so even if you're a veteran, just stick around. But first, a brief description of what a symbol or PDB is. A program database, also known as a symbol, is an integral part of debugging and is the core of debugging a live application or a memory dump. Symbols are commonly called PDBs because that's the file extension for the symbol. The format type of the program database can actually be set by Visual Studio, so I will go into a very short description of where the options are in Visual Studio. But that's basically how you create a PDB. Let me just open a C++ application in Visual Studio. Okay, so once you have the application open, just open the project settings, and I'm just going to do that off screen. And where you want to go is you want to go to the configuration properties. You want to go to linker and you want to go to debugging. This is the option where the PDB options are displayed. Don't worry about the version of Visual Studio that you're using. I'm using Visual Studio 2019, but all Visual Studios have a property page in which they show the PDB options. You might get a bit more options after Visual Studio 2017, but it really doesn't matter. For .NET applications, the PDB is also generated from a different property page. I'm not going to show that because it's basically nearly the same thing. And also in .NET, I kind of don't really worry so much about symbols because .NET debugging for managed code is kind of simpler even if you don't have symbols. So I'm going to stick to opening a native C++ application and just tweak the PDBs of the native application. Okay, at this screen, you want to click on the Generate Debug Info option. So what this option is that they give you a few options of what kind of PDB you want. The first option, no, means that you don't want a PDB. That's not what you want to select. You want to select an actual PDB. The next option, debug, debug fastlink, and debug full are different kinds of PDB. Debug full is what you want. That is the full PDB that we're going to use in WinDBG. Debug fastlink is a symbol that has less information inside, and this symbol is generated when you want to compile really, really fast. This is the default option if you choose debug mode, where you'll get a debug fastlink. I don't recommend using debug fastlink because sometimes in WinDBG, you want the information like the private symbols, and that's not available in the debug fastlink. The first option, debug by itself with no option, actually is just a selector. If you choose the first option, what will happen is that under debug mode, you will get debug fastlink, but under release mode, you will actually get debug full. So for now, what we want to do is we want to just select debug full, and we want to keep it at debug full because then our symbol for debug and for release is going to be nearly the same. I mean, debug is going to have more information, but we can use the symbol in the same way in WinDBG. The next option in the list is generate program database file. And this is pretty self-explanatory. It's the file name for the PDB. Just don't touch it. The next line is the strip private symbols. And what this option is that if you set this option on, all the private symbols within the PDB will get stripped out and they will be stored in a different PDB. The idea is that if you want to distribute the PDB to your customers or in a public forum, and you don't want people looking at the private symbols for, I don't know, maybe privacy reason, security reason, whatever it is, then set this option on. I have never actually delivered a program that I've ever found a need to hide private symbols. Maybe it's a thing. I know Microsoft symbols are stripped. You decide whether you want to do it. It's not important for this tutorial, but I will set it to off because I want to see private symbols when I use WinDBG. The next three options are generate map file, map file name and map exports. Map files are text files that contain the list of all the functions and the memory address. You can generate a map file if you want to kind of like see where the memory addresses are if you don't want to use a PDB. Like an example is that if you look at the Windows Event Viewer and you see a memory address and you want to trace it by hand, if you have a map file, you can actually calculate the memory address from the map file and you can see which function has caused the problem. It's kind of like an alternative way to using a PDB, and it's a bit easier because you can actually read what's in the file. I'm going to leave it as off right now because I just want to make a PDB and put it in WinDebug. The final option is debuggable assembly. What this option is that in .NET assemblies, there's an actual attribute which can control how the just-in-time compiler compiles the assembly. I'm going to leave this option blank. But if you are compiling a .NET assembly, you can actually fill up this option, debuggable assembly, and you can change the behavior of the just-in-time compiler. Now, alternatively, you can actually put an attribute in the assembly info CS and do the same thing. So I'm going to skip what debuggable assembly even does. I'm not particularly bothered for now. The PDB will suffice without me setting debuggable assembly. So in summary, all I'm doing is setting my generate debug info to full, and I'm just going to press OK and save it. So what this does is now, if I build this application, I'll get a PDB, and that PDB can be used in WinDebug, and it will have every symbol and every part of it that I want. I have already built the application in Visual Studio over here. So I will switch real quick to the output folder. And you can see in the output folder that next to the executable, there is the symbol. Each build generates a new PDB. The PDB has a version GUI that is used by debuggers to match the symbol to the executable. This ensures that the PDB matches exactly with no ambiguity. The version number of the executable does not matter at all, as WinDebug only uses the GUI to match the symbol to the executable. Definitely, store the PDBs in a safe location, as if you lose the files, it will be very difficult to use WinDebug and debug any executable or memory dump if they are lost. Once you have deployed an executable, rebuilding the program gets a new PDB, so you can't use new PDBs to match to older executable. Let's switch to WinDebug and actually load the symbol. So I have launched the executable in WinDebug, and you can see that it has stopped at the initial breakpoint. At this point, the symbol has been loaded. The simplest way to load a symbol is actually to just put the symbol in the same directory as the executable. If the PDB file is there, then it will load automatically when the executable loads. Symbols can be complicated to load, so WinDebug has a few debugging options. Run sim noisy to enable verbose loading, and you can use that to debug whether symbols are loading correctly. Let me just type it in real quick. So what you do is you put an exclamation, then you put sim noisy. What it will say is noisy mode, symbol prompts on. When you see that, it means that WinDebug symbols are going to be verbosely written when they are loaded, so you can use that to debug whether a symbol is loading correctly. Let me just reload the symbols with .reload. What reload does is that it dumps all the symbols that have already been loaded and reloads it again from disk. Because sim noisy was on, what we get to see is that we get to see all the parts of the PDBs that are being read off the disk. Eventually, when we debug even more, we will get more parts and we'll be able to debug if all our symbols are loading correctly. Now, all PDBs that are in the same directory have already been loaded, but we would like to load more PDBs from other locations. So the first set of PDBs that we want are the PDBs located on the Microsoft Symbol Server. So the Microsoft Symbol Server is a server on the internet that can download PDBs when we need. So what we do is we just run the command simfakes. And what that does is that it sets up the path to the Microsoft Symbol Server. the path is set up here using this format where they put the SRV in the front. This alphabet's SRV with the asterisk means that this is a path to a symbol server. The cache in the front means that it's going to cache it on my disk. That's not too important at the moment, but later on in this tutorial, I'll teach you how to write that string again so that you can choose which cache location you want. But if you don't cache the symbols that are being downloaded, they'll just download again and again and it'll be really, really slow. So always set up a cache, and even if you use the default cache, that's fine, but as long as the symbols get cached, it will be okay. If you don't cache symbols, WinDBug will be really, really slow. Type sympath again. Observe the Microsoft Symbol Server path. The Microsoft Symbol Server path has been set to sympath. Sympath is the variable in which WinDBug uses to find the paths to where the PDB files are located on disk. I can add more paths to sympath by using sympath with a plus, and then I can add another path behind it. And what will happen is that WinDBug will append the new path that I have to the existing path. I can keep appending more and more paths if I want to, and I can give it more directories to search from. How WinDBug searches is that it goes to the first directory in the list. If it can't find the symbol in there, it goes to the next one, and then the next one, and if it can't find the symbol in any of the directories, then it gives up. There is an alternate way to add the Microsoft Symbol Server path, which is to use the full name description of the path. So how I do that is I do sympath, and I put SRV, which means server, then I put an asterisk, and I can put a cache directory on my hard disk. Then I can put another asterisk, and then I can add the Microsoft Symbol Server path behind it. What this does is that it adds the path to the Microsoft Symbol Server, but it uses the cache location that I have specified. You can do this if you don't want to use the default location. It's kind of handy if you do it and you want to accumulate symbols in a particular location, but it's not really required at the beginning. Even the temporary location, it will more than suffice in WinDBug. Once all the paths have been added to WinDBug, remember to reload with .reload. What this does is that it forces WinDBug to refresh the internal tables that it uses to store the paths, and you read all the PDBs from disk. Now, WinDBug is designed to lazy load PDBs from disk. So sometimes when you reload, you won't actually see the PDB that you want being loaded. One of the tricks we can do in WinDBug is we can force a loading by searching for a symbol. So one of the simple ways we can do that is to use the X command over here. X means search in WinDBug. The format of the search is X followed by the module name. In this case, it is breakpoint 1, followed by an exclamation and the symbol to search. In this case, I'm putting the word main. The reason is that because this is a native executable, there probably is a method or a function called main in there. The asterisks are wildcards. So if I run this, what will happen is that it will read the symbols, and if the symbol is already loaded, it will pull the data from the PDB and it will show me all the symbols that have the word main in them. We can then double check where the symbol has loaded from by running lmvm and the name of the module. When we do that, we get that the loaded image is from this directory, and we get that the symbol was loaded from this directory over here. I get the information that this is a private PDB symbol. That is because when I built this symbol, I chose full debug, which generates a full PDB. If you get exported symbols or you get stripped symbols, then you'll get a different statement over here telling you that either the symbols were not found in the case of exported symbols, or they were stripped. If you run X command and it doesn't work, definitely double check whether the symbols have been loaded or they are stripped. If they have not been loaded, or they can't be found, or they are stripped, you won't really get back much information in the search. So in my case, because I built a private PDB symbol, I have all the information in the PDB. So when I did a search, all the information came out. It's quite tedious to be adding symbol paths each time we use WinDBug. So there's a short trick you can do to get WinDBG to read an environment variable. What you do is that in Windows, if you add an environment variable called __nt __symbol_path, what you can do is that you can put a string in there to become the sim path. So whatever string that you put as the value for __nt__symbol_path becomes the sim path whenever you launch WinDBG. So in my case, I actually have the Microsoft Symbol Server as my value for NT symbol path. So whenever I launch WinDBG, I automatically get the Microsoft Symbol Server. Symbol servers are not unique to Microsoft. You can run your own instance of a symbol server by using the simstore command. The command simstore is sophisticated, and I probably don't want to cover that in this video. It would make the video much longer. You don't really need to use simstore. It's just a command that kind of helps you index your symbols. As long as you store the symbols in a safe place, maybe you zip it up or just store it on a server and don't lose them, that's fine. But if you want to really make like a Microsoft symbol server, there's a command called simstore, which you can get from the WinDBG installed folder. And if you run it with the right parameters, you can create a symbol server of your own. And that is pretty much it. A simple guide to loading symbols. Now I know WinDBG is definitely a big stumbling block if symbols are not loaded. It's one of the biggest complaints that when you start using WinDBG, you can't get symbols to load. But definitely give it a try. It's actually quite easy to get the hang of it. There's just a few commands, but they're kind of a bit daunting at the beginning, but definitely don't give up. Just keep trying, reading a few tutorials, try it a few times, and you'll definitely get symbols to load correctly. Let me know in the comments if you have any other technique to load symbols in WinDBG. Definitely let me know. I would like to know more techniques and how to do it. These are just the techniques that I use. Anyway, the video is probably long enough, so a gentle reminder to give me a like if you like the video, subscribe if you want to see more, and hit that bell icon. You will get notified every time I post a new video, so definitely hit that bell icon. If you don't like the future videos, you can always unlike or unsubscribe in the future. That's fine, but definitely hit like, subscribe now so you get notified that there are new videos. It helps the channel grow and it helps me know what kind of content to produce. It's been a pleasure presenting this information. I am High Voice, signing out.